So after graduating from SMU and getting out of the U.S. Navy, I spent the next 22 years of my life really focusing on starting and running and building a variety of different businesses, the biggest of which is Weekley Homes. And then 16 years ago, I started working on public policy, trying to change public policy. And it's been an amazing undertaking. The first initiative that I undertook about 16 years ago was founding this group called Texans for Lawsuit Reform. And the purpose of this group was to try to balance the civil justice system, which was completely out of balance, and at that time it was known as the lawsuit capital of the country and probably the world. Another initiative that I was involved in, which Tony mentioned, was the Quality of Life Coalition, another group of people that got together and created this group. And the goal there was to reforest our freeways and byways and to build hike and bike trails along all the major bios crisscrossing Houston. This third group that Tony mentioned that I started 5 years ago Charles McMahon, who at that time was chairman of the Governor's Business Council. The purpose of that was to reform K-12 education. One of the things that we did that we're most proud of is we put together the largest incentive pay program anyone has put together in the country, $350 million for those teachers who have excelled in teaching K-12 education. So I've been involved in that and those three and a number of other public policy initiatives, and I have to tell you that these public policy initiatives have been at least as hard as running businesses, but very, very stimulating. So for the time that we're going to spend together, I'd like to focus really on this first public policy initiative, Texans for Lawsuit Reform, and I'd like to share the story with you in three different segments. First, I'd like to share with you how a small group of men and women went about changing public policy and passing the most comprehensive reforms in the history of the country. Secondly, I'd like to talk to you about who our opponents were and how they went about trying to oppose what we were trying to do. And then thirdly, I'd like to try to share with you how the press impacted these various debates. So when a number of my colleagues and I got together and decided to do this, we went to Austin to try to talk to people who've been working on trying to fix this system for the last 25 years. We talked to legislators, we talked to trade associations, we talked to a variety of people. And almost to one, they said, one, we had no idea what we were doing, which at the time was totally true, that we had not a chance of passing anything approaching what we wanted to try to do, and that the trial lawyers, essentially, who were opposing us on the legislature, had significant influence, and just going back to Houston, don't worry about it. Well, we didn't go back to Houston, don't worry about it. We went back to Houston, got in a friend's conference room, got up on a white blackboard or a whiteboard, and just started trying to devise a plan that we could actually impact the civil justice system and try to bring some balance back to it. So we ended up creating this organization called Texans for Lawsuit Reform. It now has 16,000 supporters across the state, representing 1,200 different types of businesses and trades and professions from over 750 cities. But let me try to share with you all the various components that you had to undertake to do a massive public policy shift. And I'm just going to go through them very, very briefly. And there are about 50 different things you need to do, but I'm going to list the top 10. The very first thing you need to do is base everything on comprehensive research. In our case, it was legal and academic research. So we did comprehensive academic legal research on every single part of the agenda that we were putting together. The second thing we did was to have market research. We need to know how to communicate our messages to the public and to the legislators. So we did focus groups, we did polling, we did all the market research to figure out how to best communicate this message. The third thing we did was to hire a legal team to write these statutes. They had to be written very crisply to make sure that when you write a statute, it's not litigated for 20 years thereafter. The fourth thing we did was to hire a lobby team. I mean, I'm like probably any of you out there in the room today, we're going to go to try to pass legislation. How do you do that? I mean, I didn't have a clue. I was in the real estate business. I had no idea how to pass legislation. So we went and we hired a lobby team, and they helped us. The fifth thing we did was to hire a media consultant. We actually met with your old publisher, Tony, in the Houston Chronicle, Dick Johnson, and we asked him how he could help us, and he said, you got to hire a media consultant. I said, what in the world is a media consultant? He said, well, you're going to be doing all this research, communicating with the public, you've got to go out and you've got to hire a media consultant because you need to be able to communicate with the media. He was so right, I cannot tell you what a huge impact he had on us. I'm so appreciative for Dick's good counsel. The next thing we did was to create a speakers bureau because we had to recruit grassroots supporters all across the state of Texas to help us in this initiative to pass this reform. So we went to Abilene and Amarillo and Tyler and Corpus and Harlingen and Orange and San Antonio and Austin, all over the state, building grassroots support for this initiative. The next thing we did was go recruit civic leaders. Many of your civic leaders here in Dallas were on board with us. And we recruited civic leaders across. Because frankly, if there's a major bill coming up and we need to talk to someone in Lubbock, it's much better if a major car dealer in Lubbock or the head of the major bank in Lubbock talks to that legislator rather than somebody from Houston or someone from Dallas calling him. So it's very important to have civic leaders around the state on your team. We then went and we recruited all the various trade associations so that everybody was on the same team. So we recruited the doctors and the hospitals and the engineers and the contractors and the builders and the realtors, and all the various trade associations got on board. And finally, we had to start raising money, which is a big problem, a lot of work, but you had to do it. Because you have to have a team of people, you got to have the money to do it, so we went out and started raising money. And then finally, the final piece of this puzzle, which I had no idea we had to get involved in, you got to get involved in politics. You must get involved in politics. I had no idea, but you got to get involved in politics. And the reason is because if your opponents are funding the other side, I thought that you could go to them and say, look, here's the polling. 85% of your people support this. Here are all the trade associations in the state who support it. Here are the reasons why it makes sense. Here's the reason the current law is flawed. Here are people in your district who have been abused by abusive lawsuits. We would very much appreciate you supporting this law. And they would go and support, they would go and vote against it. And so we finally figured out that, you know, you had to have people that would listen to common sense, listen to what their constituents said. And so we had to get involved in politics, which we did. The key point, though, of all of this is that these major initiatives must be run by volunteers. Volunteers. It's virtually impossible to hire someone to do the kind of work that we've just been going through. You must have volunteers who are willing to give up their own time and some of their own money to go and put on these initiatives. Very crucial. I initially thought that you could go and maybe ask a senator to please help you pass this. But frankly, it's not fair to them, it's not realistic. Neither the governor, the lieutenant governor, as smart as they are, any politician, any legislator, any senator, they're trying to deal with 20 or 30 or 40 different issues, have constituent issues, need to get reelected. To go and ask them to do this kind of work on one public policy issue is just not realistic, which is why I think it really, really deserves and demands volunteers. Okay, so that's kind of a process, how we went about it. So what were some of the reforms that passed? Let me just tell you a few of the things that happened. Venue shopping or forum shopping. Before we got involved in 1995, was our first session, we created the organization in 1994. If some accident happened here in Dallas, Texas, the plaintiff or the person who was injured resides in Dallas, Texas. The defendant or the person who created the accident, caused the accident, resides here. The doctors are here, the hospital is here, the witnesses are here. But you could find yourself down in South Texas trying your lawsuit. Well, I mean, how is that possible? But the way it was before 1995, if you were in an accident or there was some injury occurring, in many of these cases, the plaintiff or the person who was suing and his attorney could go shop in 254 Texas counties to try to find a good jury or a good judge that would be amenable to their cause or to their lawsuit.